You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we talk all about building your own Copilot with Azure AI Studio, a two-parter with my good friend Shanae. Make sure you tune in. Hello, and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're going to talk all about building your own Copilot with Azure AI Studio, a two-parter. This is part one with my friend Shanae. Shanae, tell us who you are and what you do.
Hi, everyone. My name is Shanae Winner, and I'm a senior product manager on the Azure AI team. And I currently work on our UI experiences in the AI Studio.
Fantastic. And so for those that don't know what the Azure AI Studio is, can you fill us in? What problems it's supposed to solve? Who is it for? That kind of thing.
Yeah, sure. So the Azure AI Studio essentially is a unified platform for all of our AI services to allow users to build their generative AI applications and also copilots.
That's amazing. Now, is it hard to use? What kind of applications should people be thinking I should use this? Is there something you can show us? What do you got?
Yeah, definitely not hard to use. I'm going to show you how easy it is to build your own copilot from scratch using Azure AI Studio. Today, we're going to focus on building a Q&A, like a chat box, question and answer copilot. But there are many, many applications. You could do like text generation. You could do semantic searches, different things, depending on your need. But I'm going to show you how easy it is to get started. Don't worry.
All right. Let's take a look. You got something to show us? Let me bring your screen up.
Yeah. So this is the AI Studio that I just mentioned. And essentially today I'm going to focus on a customer called Treeholics. And Treeholics specializes in tree and plant varieties. And we're going to build a copilot, a question Q&A, to allow customers, when they come to the Treeholics website, to ask questions, and we'll be able to give them an answer. So the first thing you want to do is get the right model for this Q&A. This is where you'll go to the model catalog, where we have thousands of models by like Azure OpenAI, But we have thousands of models by Azure OpenAI, by Hugging Face, and so on. And the first thing I want to do is actually start looking for Q&A model. So I click here on question and answer filtering on the right. And if you notice, I have a whole ton of models here, Seth, yeah, like a bunch. Okay. I could even go to the next page. And for me, this is a bit overwhelming. So I like to use a tool called Benchmarks, which is right here, that allows me to compare model performance. So as you can see here, we have the question and answering task that we're looking at. And I can easily just compare these models and see the actual performance of these models. So just by a quick glance, you could already tell that the GPT-4 model is performing the best based on like accuracy and coherence and these metrics that you see here. So for me, that's a clear indicator, if these metrics are important for my task, that I can leverage this GPT-4 model.
That makes sense. And so you're able to benchmark these things based on any number of tasks, or are there certain tasks that are better to benchmark against others?
Yeah, good question. So today we support Q&A and text generation, and we support on a handful of models that you can see here. And these models actually tested on these common like industry standard data sets. So today we don't support all of the tasks, but some of them you'll be able to find here.
Yeah, but if you scroll down, this is something that I hadn't seen before. It looks like there's a chart that does the model accuracy against all of these data sets. And so, like, for example, bigger models are more expensive, smaller models are less expensive, but maybe less accurate. And so maybe you could even find your sweet spot for your particular kind of application.
Exactly, Seth. So this is a tool that, you know, I love to use, especially when there are like so many models to choose from, and I just need that extra guidance to choose the best model for my task, that I come here to get that information.
I love it. Another question I want to ask is, this is the Azure AI Studio. I'm going to put a little link. You just go to ai.azure.com and you can set up an account if that's what you want to do. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's super easy. So you don't have to do anything to get these metrics. You just set up, you sign in, and this is already done for you. These are metrics that we generate for you to look at and learn more about.
Amazing. All right. So what's the next step? Once we got to pick a model now, right?
Right. So I pick a model. So let's say I go with GPT-4. And actually for this demo, probably let's just do GPT-3.5 because this is a bit cheaper. So I'm going to use this one. So what I can do is I can easily just deploy this model, right? So I have already deployed this actually in my project. And this is my project here called Shrin Demo. And before I jump into how you'll actually use this model and deployment, I want to talk a little bit about our project, because the project is a really awesome way for you to organize your work and also save the state of your work. And here you can see, I can easily see the infrastructure that my project is running on, the connections, and I even see permissions, like who I gave access to my project. So if someone gets you upset, you could just remove them and don't give them permissions.
Notice that there is no Seth in that particular project. I probably was removed.
I wonder why, So I want to focus a little bit about this Azure AI resource. And this AI resource is essentially a hub that manages the resources for your project. So you can set up your Azure OpenAI connection, your storage connection, and essentially create multiple projects using this Azure AI resource. And so the good thing is, like, you set this up once and multiple projects can be created from this. So that sort of streamlines the setup and management of your resources for your projects.
So let me see if I understand this correctly. So effectively, like, because this stuff is backed by Azure, you have an Azure resource. The hub is, did you call it the hub? I think that's what you called it.
Well, and then, I call it that's a, you know, a term that helps me understand. It's a hub for all of my, you know, resources, something that, like a common in, like setup.
Got it. And then you can have multiple projects inside of that resource. Can these multiple projects share resources or
that is exactly it. Yep. And that's the beauty of using the Azure AI resource. You can share the resources without having to create a new connection each time you create a project.
I see. Okay, that makes sense. All right, what's next?
Yeah, so I've gone through just the boring stuff of, you know, the project overview. Let's actually test this deployment. So as you can see here, I've already created my deployment and I want to now test it and use it in the playground. And the playground is a really good place for you to experiment with like your models and deployments. So as I mentioned before, we're looking at a company called Treeholics. And I want to ask, like, what is Treeholics' return policy? I type that in here. And it's, if you can see, the model actually...
It returned something.
It did return something, but
yeah. And here's the thing: this is a fun little thing. Like, I always tell people, and you tell me what you think, that you should never use these things as databases. You should use them as language calculators, because here the model, I don't know if it knows anything about your company, but it looks like it's talking about return policy that I don't think you've even told it about. Is that the case?
Yeah, yes, that's true. So it's telling me something about return policy, partly maybe because I was testing it before this call. It's probably remembering some things. Yeah. But what I do want to point out is, like, right now, this information that the model is producing is not grounded in my company data. I don't see any references. I don't even know if this is the correct return policy because it's not actually referencing my company data. So that's something that I want to make sure that the model is grounded in order to give me more accurate results.
And you know what's cool? What's cool is that I think you were expecting it to say, I don't know. But the thing that it said something, it should be scary to everyone out there, because we want to make sure that anytime you use these things, you do ground them in your actual data, because irrespective of what model you're using, you need to make sure that it's referencing correct information. And that's, I think, what you're going to do next, correct?
Yes, exactly. So it's giving me some answer that's not really pertaining to my company. So what I want to do here is actually add some data.
Let's do it.
The good thing here, Seth, is that so many of the amazing Azure data connections are available for you to leverage. So you can, you know, connect to OneLake or Fabric and so on. But I'm just going to use like Azure AI Search, connect to my service. And I've actually created an index of my data for my company previously. I am also going to add vector search because this is such a great way to improve the searching capabilities. And let me just talk a little bit about search here. So on the back end, we, of course, use a pipeline to, you know, open up the documentation and chunk the information and then use an embedding model to embed this data. So that's why I have to select an embedding model here, the ADA model to help with that text embedding. And once I acknowledge that, I can then select the type of search. So here you can see that I've selected hybrid and vector keyword search. And the good thing about vector search is that it understands user intent or like the relationship between words. So in this scenario, like words like tree or planting or seeds, it tends to like understand the relationship there. And the good thing about keyword search is that it's good for exact matches. So if I want to search specifically for something, that helps using the keyword search. So I like the best of both worlds. So I'm going to select hybrid search.
We want lunch and dessert. And so we're going to have both when it comes to search. Oh, it's almost rhymed when I said it. That's one of the few things that like Azure AI Search does better than all the other ones, as far as I know.
Yep. So as you can see here, Seth, I have added my index. So this will now ground my model. So now I can ask it something specific to my company. So let's say I ask, what products does Treeholics sell? And let's see what we get. There so you here go. You can see, Seth, like, that this information is now grounded in my company data. I can see the references to which part of my documents that this answer came from. And it's telling me clearly like the types of trees and plants that this company provides. But I want to show something a little fun. What if I ask the same question, but in Spanish or Ooh. Another language? Right, let's see what happens here. Here you can see that the model has produced a similar answer, also referencing my documentation, but now in Spanish. So this is really awesome, Seth, because like imagine you have customers from around the world visiting your website, the Treeholics site, and you know customers speak different languages. So they can come, they can ask a question in Dutch or Spanish or English, and then get a response to help them make an informed decision. So I think that's pretty awesome.
That's really cool. And you didn't have to do anything else to make it work other than just ask it in Spanish, and it worked.
Exactly. So the playground supports multilingual support today for this model. So there's nothing that you have to actually configure, which is really awesome.
So one of the things that I noticed is that you had kind of an index pre-built. What if the user, what if someone's like using this stuff and they're like, I don't have an index. Are you able to build those things inside of this studio as well?
Yeah, so you can definitely from the playground upload data, but you can also go to the data tab and create your index. So I did this beforehand, but this is where you can see, you know, we support different connections to Azure data sources like OneLake or Fabric. You could even like upload your own information from your local computer. So if you have documents or data on your local device, you can also upload it and create that index that you can then reference in the playground. Or you could simply just add it to the playground here as well. So either one, whichever one works for you.
All right, so you showed us a bunch of stuff in the playground, and I know I try to get ahead of myself, but now that you've done this stuff in the playground and you've tried it out, what would be the next step for someone building these kinds of applications?
Yeah, so Seth, it's easy for me to, you know, write one question at a time, but what if I have like multiple questions that I want to evaluate? This is where I would leverage the manual evaluation. Okay. And this, as you can see, it's already connected to the model that I had in the playground. If I go to data, you can also see that my index is still connected.
Oh, yeah, from before.
Yep, exactly. So I can ask a question here and see how the model responds, or I can upload a data set to evaluate this model. So I actually already have a test data set. So let's click on this one. And it's super easy. All I have to do is load this up and then do some quick mapping. And then once I do that, you see that I have my input, I have my expected output, and I'm going to evaluate how this model actually like works and what the output is. So I could do it for one, but then I could show you what it looks like for multiple.
That's cool. And so effectively what you're doing is you're trying to figure out, like, I want the model to respond this way, and you're giving some tests with some baseline questions and answers, and this will actually make it so that it will give you the answer and maybe even a score. Is that right?
Yes, exactly. So here you can see it gave me an answer. And I can then evaluate how well this answer was or how good it was, which I've already done, actually. So let me go to, and here you can see it actually updated. As I was speaking, it updated here. Yeah. And I could rank whether this was a good or bad response. But I've already done this. So let me show you just an example of one of my manual evaluations that I did for this Treeholics Q&A. And it actually performed pretty well, where I was able to go through and see, based on the input, what the expected output was, and basically evaluate how well it performed manually.
That's cool. So as you're doing this stuff manually, I'm seeing like a thumbs up and a thumbs down. Can you tell us a little bit about what that is?
Yeah, exactly. So this is where the manual evaluation comes in. So as you can see, I can thumbs up or thumbs down this, and it changes the score, as you can see here. And based on how well the model performed, then you could actually go and like iterate on this assistant and this model. So whether that means changing the prompt, the meta prompt, whether that means changing or improving your data, and you could run this again and see how that model performs and evaluate the performance of this model.
That's really cool. And so you can have confidence that this thing is doing the right thing with the data that you've given it, correct?
Exactly. So this is a good way to test multiple inputs.
Amazing. So if people are looking at this, how would they use this inside of their application? Is there some code that they give you so that you can put in your application?
So really, really good question, Seth. And this is where I want to talk a little bit about prompt flow.
Oh,
yeah.
Interesting. And that feels like the second part. But there's some code that I've seen here. There's a button right there. Do you see that view code button?
Yep. So this is the sample code that you can then use to integrate in your application.
I see.
So this is something that if you depending on how you rather work or your preferred IDE, this is where you can get your sample code to leverage and use in your application.
I see. And then you started talking about, like, I was like, what if you want to do more customization? And you're like, ah, Seth, that's just when we start talking about something called prompt flow. And I feel like this is a good stopping point so that we can maybe do a little summary of what it is that we've talked about and then, you know, get people excited about the next episode. So can you give us a summary of what we've seen and how people can find out more?
Yeah, so what you saw was the Azure AI Studio, which is the place to do your Gen AI applications and copilots. Today, we looked at a company called Treeholics that wanted to essentially build a Q&A chat box for their website to help customers get answers quickly to common questions. So what we did was first find the best model for our scenario. We did that by leveraging benchmarks to help us choose the right model for our task. We then deployed that model in our project, and we then experimented with that model in the playground. We did test a few things in the playground, but we then leveraged manual evaluation to see how well that model performed. And of course, you can do additional customization in the playground and access the code if you need to.
And this is really cool because it's a really nice way to like get your fingers wet and really figure out if this is going to be a solution for you, not just with playing stuff in the playground, but also doing some manual evaluations to figure it out. And was that the intent all along?
Yep, definitely. You hit the nail on the head.
Well, I'm learning stuff. If you want to learn more about Azure AI Studio, there's some stuff here that you can learn from. And then obviously there's some documentation that you can take a look at for Azure AI Studio. So thank you, Shanae, for being with us, my friend.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me, Seth.
Awesome. And thank you so much for watching. We're learning all about building your own copilot with Azure AI Studio, part one. Stay tuned. Part one. Stay tuned for part two, where we talk about how to go even deeper. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.